That's what we're going to sing. Good morning and welcome to Arbor Christian Fellowship. The battle belongs to the Lord. We've just been listening to it. We're going to sing it just like that. Let's stand together.
In heavenly armor will enter the land. The battle belongs to the Lord. No weapon that's fashioned against us shall stand. The battle belongs to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. When the power of darkness comes in like a flood, the battle belongs to the Lord. He's raised up a standard, the power of his blood. The battle belongs to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. When your enemy presses in hard, do not fear. The battle belongs to the Lord. Take courage, my friend, your redemption is near. The battle belongs to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. And we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. Power and strength to the Lord.
Just keep standing. We'll sing, to God be the glory, great things he hath done. And that's practically a quote right out of Scripture. The Lord has done great things for us, and we were joyful. It's Psalms 126:3. To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who here in his life an atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, a purchase of blood, to every believer a promise of God. Defender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But poorer and higher and greater will be our victory when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Thank you. You may be seated. Good morning. Welcome to Arbor this morning. We're glad you're here, and happy Mother's Day. Amen. God is good. And all the time? Amen. We're glad you're here. And as our first Pastor Talbert said, there are no strangers here, just friends we haven't met. Would you take a moment and say Happy Mother's Day to our mom and tell people Jesus loves you? Would you do that right now? Well, we're glad you're here today, and it's so nice to see all the families with their moms. And I was driving by, we live in front of a cemetery, and as I drove by the cemetery this morning, I was amazed, as early as it was, to see the number of cars and the number of people at the cemetery. And then I went by the other cemetery on El Toro Road, and it was just as full. And what a privilege it is to be here today with your mom and to be able to love her. And if Allison over here, Allison, could come all the way from South Africa to visit her mom on Mother's Day, there's no excuse for you, particularly online, to give your mom a call or to go visit your mom, because that's a short distance. And we're going to honor our moms this morning because they are very special to us. There's only one announcement. The deacon body will make a recommendation at a business meeting. We couldn't hold a business meeting today. There wasn't enough time. Next week is Memorial Day. Everybody's going to be gone. So it will be the first weekend in June that we'll make a recommendation for the names on the pastor search committee. So mark that on your calendar to be here. We'll have a discussion and a vote to get a committee going for the pastor search committee. So things are moving, and we are glad you're here. And where's God's kids? Well, good morning. Good morning. You all look beautiful, and you look handsome. Yeah, wow. So who got you guys ready this morning? Who combed your hair?
My mother. Mother.
Mom must have been busy with your sister or brother or something, right? Oh, your mom's at work. Okay. All right. Well, praise the Lord, right? Because she's taking care of somebody, right?
My mom. Myself.
Yourself. Kind of looks like it. Okay. You did what I did. Okay. So, let me read you here something from the Bible. Proverbs 31 talks about mom, right? Her children stand beside and bless her. Her husband praises her. There are many virtuous and capable women in the world, but you surpass them all. And you know what's interesting about Proverbs 31? Do you know how important are moms to God?
Very important.
Very important, yes.
Very important.
And very important, and that's a second. All in favor, say amen.
Amen.
All opposed, say no. Motion carries unanimously, right? Mom, oh, we got one more, okay. Mom and mom who made yourself. Okay, that's good. All right, so do you know that Proverbs 31, moms are so important to God that is the longest description of a family member in the Bible? Did you know that? Yeah, that's how important moms are, right? So when you get a cut or you hurt yourself, who do you go to? Go to the hospital? Okay. Who takes you to the hospital? Who takes you to the hospital? Sometimes your mom's there so you don't have to go to the hospital, right? And who prays for you when you get a boo-boo or you get something? Did you know that moms pray for you constantly? Yeah? How do you know that?
Because my mom prays for me every day.
How do you know that?
Because in the morning she does. Anytime I pray, she'll pray for me.
Wow, isn't that great? How else do we know that our moms love us? How do they show it?
Hugs, kisses, caring for each other.
Yeah, absolutely, right? Hugs and kisses are the best, aren't they? So, when we, do you know what the number one thing that moms want to hear? What they want to get? Do they want to get, what do moms want to get?
Us to say, I love you and thank you for everything that you've done for us.
Hey, you know what? 85% of the moms said, rather than flowers, rather than a gift, they just want to hear, I love you. And they would like a card written by you because that means more to them than flowers and gifts and all the other stuff, right? So if you get a chance today, right, make a little special card for your mom, right? Wow, okay. Well, you're way ahead. Genius child here. Okay.
I need a card for my mom too.
Okay, praise the Lord. Two genius childs.
And I already gave it to her.
You already gave it to her. Well, praise the Lord. Okay.
I made a card for every mom in the family.
Wow, that's great. That's great. Praise the Lord. Well, that is the most important thing that you can give to your mom, okay? So today, okay, Carter.
I painted a picture for her.
Very good. Very good. That's so special. Okay, so today we want to recognize some moms, okay? So can you guys help us pass out some roses so we can recognize the moms?
Yes.
Okay, all right. Pastor Jonathan?
All right, happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there. And it is such a special day. Every Sunday is a special day, but God has designed this day that we honor our mothers. And it's amazing how God designed or ordained Mother's Day and also Father's Day. Because if God didn't ordain these dates, we would never talk about it. As pastors, we would just say, oh, we have more important things to talk about. And so when there's Mother's Day and Father's Day, it allows us to pause and just reflect on the importance of our mother and our fathers in our lives. So today we're honoring our mothers. And Of course, I had a mother, and without my mother, I don't know where I'd be. My father passed away when I was 7 years old, and so my mother raised us by herself. She was only 38 when my father passed away, and she never married, and she raised us four kids by herself. And so I honor my mother today and for what God has given to me. And so today, I just want to just reflect on how amazing mothers are and the blessing that God has given the family unit as a gift, as a mother. But the thing is, I know during Mother's Day, though, I know that many people come in with different emotions. A lot of times, it's not a happy moment. A lot of times, Mother's Day is not a happy moment, and we have to be sensitive to that and understand that sometimes Mother's Day brings not only happiness and joy to other people, but sometimes sadness, because maybe your mom passed away. Or you're maybe separated from your mom. I know some people in my church, they haven't seen their mom in 20 years because their mom is in the Philippines and they're here. And so Mother's Day comes around and they just, it's sad because they miss their mom so much. Sometimes Mother's Day brings on bitterness and anger, because sometimes maybe your mom wasn't the best or wasn't the greatest. And so when Mother's Day comes around, sometimes it brings bitterness to people. And we need to be sensitive to that. Maybe if you're a mom, maybe some people in my church, mothers dread Mother's Day because they've lost a child. Or, you know, something, you know, some hurt and some pains are there. And here's another thing, Mother's Day comes around too, and sometimes mothers feel inadequate. Like, I'm not worthy to be honored. I've done such a bad job. I don't know what to do. But whatever the case, you've come in here today, God says that we should honor mothers and honor the role of motherhood. So I want to honor all the mothers here today and lift you up, and I want to pray for you. So if you're willing, can I have all the mothers come forward, and we can stand on this side? And again, this is not forced. If you don't feel like coming up, it's okay. This is just for those who would like to come forward, and then I could pray for you. So can I ask all the mothers to come forward, whoever would like to come forward? And so we can give you a gift. The children can give you a gift and honor the amazing mothers that you are. All right, so this is an amazing set of women right here. This is an army that this church has. What an amazing blessing and the Church of God has. So we want to honor them today. So we have flowers to pass out to them. All right, kids, I want you to get these flowers, and I want you to make sure, and kids, come on up. If your mom's here, I want you to get a flower and bring it to your mom and enjoy the blessing of giving it to her. Okay. And if your mom is not here, you can come get a flower for your mom to give to, later on.
Kayla, Camila can get a flower for your mother.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So on this stage is mothers who God has blessed us with. And here's the thing, there's biological mothers, adoptive mothers, and also spiritual mothers, where a spiritual mother guides someone to the Lord. And so here are women who are biological mothers, maybe. Some are adoptive mothers, and some, most of them are all spiritual mothers, where they are designed to guide people and children to the Lord and other women. So a wealth of knowledge, a wealth of experience, a wealth of wisdom, a wealth of joy, a wealth of memories, a wealth of pain, a wealth of grief. And these are just amazing mothers that God has blessed us with. Let's thank the Lord for that. Amen. Amen. And so let's pray for them. And remember, children and everyone, Mother's Day is just not for Mother's Day, the second Sunday of May. Mother's Day is every day, right? You treat your mothers with honor every single day. Amen. One picture for you guys before I pray for you. All right, let's pray for them. Dear Father God, we are so thankful that you have ordained the family unit from the very beginning. You ordained a father and a mother, and children to incorporate a family unit, and how you have blessed, Father, this unit with a mother. Father, they are so skillful, they are so talented, and they are, Father, you have given them amazing ability, Lord, to raise up children and direct them to the Savior. To raise up children, Lord, to teach them about the Lord. To raise them up, Lord, to be people of God. And Father, what a noble and amazing task. And Father, we just thank you, Lord, for them, and bless them, Lord, comfort them, guide them, Father, and strengthen their hearts as they continue, Father, this role of motherhood. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Let's give them a hand again. All right, amen. And before we go on with music, we have a special guest today, Allison. She is the daughter of Mary Baldwin, and she is a missionary to Africa, correct? And she comes here and there to come give a report. And so that while she's here, we'd like to have her just give a short report of what she's doing in the ministry.
Good morning. Happy Mother's Day. It's so good to see you guys. It's rare that I get to visit twice within 6 months. So my update will be shorter today because I saw you guys 6 months ago. Not a whole lot has changed except for there's a ring on my finger now. So a lot of you guys got to meet Vickis when he was here with me in November. We're getting married 2 months from today. So we're in the final countdown, getting married very soon. But I just wanted to share an update with you guys on where we're at and what we're stepping into in this next season. As Pastor Jonathan said, I am Allison. I'm a missionary in South Africa. I've been there for about 4.5 years now. And we are currently running a 6-month discipleship training school. That will be, I think, the last time that I run one of these schools. I am going to be, my role in South Africa is going to be changing a little bit moving forward. But this 6-month school we've been in has been so fun, so fruitful. We have about 115 short-term missionaries on the field right now all across the world that we launched out from South Africa. They're in the Philippines, Kyrgyzstan, Nepal, India, Paraguay, and 4 different nations in Africa. And in the last 4 weeks that they've been on the field, we've seen about 1,000 people across the globe make decisions for Christ. We've preached the gospel to over 3,000 people. And we're just seeing God move in wild ways in places like Kyrgyzstan, where I think in the Central Asia, in all the Stan countries, there's about 1 missionary for every 400,000 people. And so just imagine if you alone were responsible for sharing the gospel to almost 500,000 people. And so we're seeing places that historically, statistically, are deemed as really hard places where we're seeing God move in ways that we haven't yet. Last year, we sent a team to Kyrgyzstan, and in 6 weeks, they saw four people make decisions for Christ. And this year, our team went there, and in just the first week on the ground, they saw five. And so we're seeing the persistence of God just breaking up the soil in these places that have been hard in the past, and we're seeing the fruitfulness of the persistence in some of these places, which is so encouraging. And so they have our teams have a few more weeks left on the field before they come back to South Africa and finish their outreach in country there. In July, we'll finish the DTS and graduate them. And then I get married, which will be so fun. And then after a honeymoon, Vickis and I will come back, and he will be leading 3-month Bible schools on our base, where these schools go from Genesis to Revelation, teaching young people how to tell the story of God from the beginning until what is still to come. So he'll be doing that for the next couple of years, and I am going to be stepping into something called The Send, which is going to take place September 2025 in what is called FNB Stadium, which is the largest stadium in Africa, and we're aiming to gather 87,000 people from primarily South Africa, but all across the continent, to see young people activated into a missional lifestyle as believers. So whether that is as vocational missionaries going to the nations, or whether that is to things like adoption, church planting, high schools, universities, things like that, there is different outcomes that we'll make available for people to respond to see South Africans activated into missions. So that is going to be taking up a lot of my time for the next year and a half to 2 years while we mobilize for that. So that is just going to involve lots of touring, partnership with local churches across the nation, and getting believers on board with this event that we really believe is going to be so impactful. In addition to that, on our base right now, we are in day, I think, 70, where we have 70 days left to raise about $1 million, because we're purchasing our first really big building. So we're purchasing some property that has been the largest bar and nightclub in our town, and the owner asked us, the owner of this bar came to us and asked us, will you please take this off my hands? Will you please? He's like, I want to make this right. I want to see God redeem this building to be used for something for His glory, and I want to wipe my hands clean of this. So the owner actually came to us and asked us if we would purchase it. And this specific property is a place where for the last 4.5 years since we've been in South Africa, we have been praying and believing and dreaming about turning into a gathering space, office space, and ultimately a house of prayer to be used for the glory of God, a place where missionaries could be trained up and sent out. So a lot of our South Africans who were raised up in Potch actually made a lot of bad decisions in this place while they studied in Potchefstroom, and now we are in the process of purchasing it and turning it into a house of prayer, which is pretty wild. So there's a lot going on in South Africa, but that's just a little bit of an update for you guys. Arbor has been in my prayers so much in these last 6 months, especially after Pastor Danny graduated to glory. So yeah, you guys have been in my prayers, and I just thank you that I've been in yours as well. I feel it. And every time I come home, I know I say this every time, but I'm so thankful for this church, having had grown up in this church, and just a place to come home where you guys have known me since I was like this big. So thank you guys, and love you.
Just by way of reminding you about our morning offering, in the old days we passed a plate. Everybody contributed by that. Since COVID, we've stopped doing that. The plates are always right here in the front or on the right as you go out through the back. But I want to remind you something about giving of your offering, your tithe, whatever it is, whatever way you refer to it. You know that we have a number of programs the church carries on, ministries of different kinds. One of those is Awana. And this year, on Wednesday night, we decided to start a Bible reading plan with the new Tyndale Bible Messiah. And we've invited those parents of the Awana kids to come into that if they're not busy in Awana. And I want to tell you about one of the mothers that is in that group. They're all mothers, of course, and their husbands. But one of the mothers in that group just published a book called Surviving the Storms of Life. And she tells the story of how her mother died when she was 14 or 15 years old. And she basically lived on her own for the rest of her life. But she's ministering to us because of that experience. We're ministering to her because of our tithes and offerings by talking about the Bible every week. We have another couple in that class that are off to Japan this week as a missionary trip, so that's exciting as well. These are all folks who are not members of our church. We just see them on Wednesday nights, but God is doing great things there, and that's very exciting. Let's pray for a moment about our offering. Father, thank you so much for the opportunity to give a part of our tithe or our offering, that your work can be extended, not just right here in Orange County, but throughout the world through the cooperative program. We pray it in Jesus' name, for his sake. Amen. We're going to sing again, Indescribable. Next one, very easily. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, 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 Lord. sing hallelujah to the Lord. It's that simple. We'll sing it together. Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
Sing hallelujah to the
Lord. Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah. Sing hallelujah.
Sing hallelujah to the Lord.
Sing hallelujah to the
Lord.
Jonathan Dignity Say, our new intro pastor.
Amen. Amen. All right. Thank you. Thank you so much. If you can rise, if you're able to, I'd like to read our passage for the day. It's our Mother's Day passage that I'd like to just share. This comes from one of my favorite passages, Proverbs 31, verses 30 to 31. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain. But a woman who fears the Lord shall be praised. Give her the product of her hands, and let her works praise her in the gates. You may be seated. Dear Father, we are thankful once again for Mother's Day, and that, Father, you have ordained this moment just to honor our mothers. And by honoring our mothers, Father, we are actually honoring you. And so, Father, we honor you today, and we thank you, Lord, once again, for the amazing role of motherhood. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. So being in the ministry for so many years, I've been exposed to many people, and I've been exposed to many women and men, and I've been exposed to many husbands and mothers, and observing mothers, I have come to know that there are some certain things that traits that the mothers that I see that are very godly and very steadfast and very strong, they have these three traits that I want to share today to encourage the mothers today. But today, it seems to me that the role of motherhood is being attacked today in our world, that the role of motherhood is less significant. It doesn't have a lot of value. In fact, nowadays, it's more like if you children are a burden, and they are a burden to advancements and careers and all these things. And so in our world today, motherhood is being kind of pushed aside. You never hear of families with 8 kids anymore, 9 kids, right? Back in my day, it was like 7 kids for a family, 8 kids. My wife's mother had like 13, But nowadays, it's more, the more children you have, the more burden it is. And so motherhood is kind of being seen and being undervalued a little bit. But God has ordained motherhood, and God has created motherhood, and the daily task of the household and all these things, God ordained it. In fact, I had a talk with my my daughter the other day. Oh, by the way, if you guys don't know, that's my family there. If I could introduce them to you, that's my family. My son there is Levi Jordan. I named my kids after a biblical name and after one of my favorite basketball players at the time. So that's Levi Jordan for Michael Jordan, and that's Isaiah Wade. And Rudy is named after my father-in-law, and her name is Rudy, and her middle name is Joy, because that was his favorite topic to talk about. And then my youngest is named Samuel, and his middle name is Nash, for Steve Nash. Anyways, that's my amazing family, and I don't know what my family would do without my wife, their mother. Their mother is like the glue that makes a whole household run. And so without her, I don't know where we'd be. And so I was talking to my daughter, and I didn't ask her. So Rudy, I apologize. So I had a talk with my daughter, and I said, Rudy, what do you want to be, as a career? What do you want to go to school for? And she said something that just shocked me. She said, I want to be a housewife. I want to be a mother. That's my dream. That's my goal. It's just I want to take care of the house and all these things. I'm saying, what? No way. Even me, I was like, what? You want to do that? That's what you want to do? And she goes, yeah. And I said, well, and I didn't want to discourage her. I said, well, that's good, Rudy. And I think that's a great thing that she has that. But I said, well, my mom, if she didn't have a career, if she didn't have something to fall back on, when my father passed away, well, how would she, how would we survive? So I said, Rudy, yeah, you should go to school for something, just as a backup. And I said, go to school that would make you a better mom. Whatever it is, go to school that will make you a better mom. Go to finance, because you need to run the household with finance, right? You gotta be able to know how to balance a budget and do this and that, so why don't you take finance? That'll make you a better mom. Or maybe be a nurse, go for nursing. You'd be a great mom. You'll know how to, fix boo-boos, and when kids are sick, you know what to do. Man, my wife is a nurse, and that's why I wanted to marry a nurse. That's one of my checklists for God. I said, God, I want three things: that she loves you, and that she loves working with young people, and that she's a nurse. Can I have those three things? And when I was speaking to her for the first time, and I was talking to her, I was like doing the checklist. Okay, she loves God. She's a pastor's kid. She loves God. Oh, she's a youth leader. There was a check. And then I finally, oh God, please, let me have this third thing. And I was talking to her, and come to find out, she was in Biola taking nursing. That was triple check. And so that's why she's my wife. But that's what I told her, is that having this desire to be a mother and stay home, that's a great thing. But also, be prepared to also, for the hard times, and have something as a backup as well. And so motherhood is a very difficult task. You mothers, I don't have to tell you how difficult motherhood can be. The multitasking that most men don't have. Mothers have this multitasking ability that they could be changing a diaper and cooking at the same time. They could do so many things at the same time. And so it's amazing that God has given you that ability, and what a blessing it is. So I want to address the mothers, the three characteristics that I believe that I've seen that gives you strength and courage and steadfastness as being a mother. But before I do that, I want to address the children first. Because how you deal with your mother is one of the most important things that God has given to you. If you look at the Ten Commandments, the first four were about God, your relationship with God. The next 5 to 10 is your relationship with the world and with people. And the very first group of people that God wanted you to have a good relationship with was your mother and your father. It's right there. After God, how you deal with your mother and father is one of the most important things of a Christian, how you deal with them. And so I want to address the children first. All right? Exodus verse 20, verse 12. And again, I'm so glad that God ordained this time, because if God didn't ordain motherhood or Mother's Day, Father's Day, I wouldn't even be talking about this. I would have other things to talk about, some deeper theological or something else, but this is the core of our Christian life. Exodus 20, verse 12, honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving to you. Honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long, that the Lord your God is giving to you. Honor your father and your mother. It doesn't say honor your father and your mother if they're good. It doesn't say honor your father and mother if they're perfect. It doesn't say honor your father and mother if they, you know, give everything to you. It just says honor your father and your mother. Because we know that fathers and mothers are not perfect. But it says we honor them despite all that. It doesn't say honor and obey your father and your mother. It just says honor your father and your mother. Because here's the thing, reason why in the Ten Commandments it doesn't say honor and obey your father and mother. Because obedience to your father and mother is not a lifetime. There comes a point where a child grows up and they no longer obey their father and their mother, but they obey God. So obeying your father and your mother is not a lifetime. Honoring them is a lifetime. And what does the word honor mean? It's a Hebrew word. It's called kabed. It means to give much weight, to give a lot of value. In the Hebrew, when there's something that's heavy in terms of the scale, the heavier something is, the more value you give it. So when it says honor, it means give your parents, your father and mother, a lot of weight in your life. Give them a lot of value in your life. Whether they're good, whether they're bad, whether just you honor them because God gave them to you. And through your father and your mother, God gave you life. So you give them honor and you give them respect because God has given them to you, and you cherish them. You have a high view of them. This is my father and mother God has given to me. And again, it's not because they're perfect and they're good. And I shared this with you before. My mother, although I love her to death, she wasn't a perfect mom. She had anger issues. She had some personal issues. She had, cleaning issues. She wanted everything clean and spotless. And so she would always get mad at us when things aren't clean and spotless. And I told people here before that she would yell at us for 6 hours, sometimes 8 hours, little kids. And she would yell at us for 8 hours at one stretch. From when the sun is up until the sun is down, she's yelling at us. And of course, sometimes she disciplined us with physical spankings. And today, my mom would be considered that was too much. I remember one time my brother stole a yo-yo from a 7-Eleven, and it was one of these nice yo-yos, one that when you flip it, it lights up. And so my brother stole this yo-yo, and he got caught. And I was with him, and the guy took my brother to the back. They called the police, and he told me to go get my mom. I got my mom. She came and she paid for the yo-yos, and they were generous enough not to press charges. And we went home, and my mom, a belt to the point of welts in the legs. But here's the thing, though, when she was spanking my son, my brother, she said, "I need to do this to you because I don't want the police to do it to you. I want to spank you because I don't want the police to spank you." And so because of that, my brother never stole again. Never stole again. But my mom was not perfect. She was so frustrating to me. Sometimes she would use things and get us angry. Like we would say, "Mom, can we go somewhere and do something and go to a party or go to a friend's house?" And she would always say yes, right? But then we know that if she gets mad, she'll say no again. And so whenever she said yes to an activity, man, we'd be so happy, but we made sure the house is clean. We're running around the house, cleaning the house, because we know that if she gets mad, she's gonna take it away from us. And she did this countless of times, where she uses these things to control us, kind of. And so this one time, I don't know what it was, but it was a major thing that we wanted to go to, my brothers and I. Going to someone's house, or I don't know, Disneyland or something, but it was so big. And we cleaned the whole house so that way she wouldn't be mad. But then she got mad about something. And then she said we couldn't go. And man, I was so angry. My brothers were so angry. But I remember Exodus 20:12 from a little boy. I was taught this: to honor your father and your mother, no matter what. And so I was angry. My brother was angry. But my brother was so angry to the point of calling my mother the B word. Yeah, the B word. And I was alarmed. And I told my mom, this is my older brother, and I'm the third, so he's way bigger than me. And I said, "Hey, brother, you can't call mom that. You can't call mom that. I don't care what she says." And I'm a little, you know, 9-year-old boy. So you can't call mom that. And he says to me, "What are you going to do about it?" I'm like a little boy. But I was training Kung Fu with Bruce Lee movies, right? So I knew how to fight, right? I could take him. But he was like, "What are you going to do about it?" I said, no, bro, I don't want to fight you. Just don't call mom that word. I don't care what she does. Don't call mom that word. So what are you going to do about it?" And he comes up to me. And he starts punching me, right? And in the Filipino culture, you never hit your older brother. Because even though he's wrong, if I hit him, then I become wrong. And I become scolded. So I refrained from hitting my brother, but he just started hitting me and everything. But later on, he apologized. But even as a young boy, I knew that no matter what my mom did to me or whatever she did, that honor has always got to be there. That honor has always got to be there. And that is a very sanctifying place. Because my mom, again, she had a very sinful attitudes. But here's the thing, though. Later on in life, I realized that my mom, man, she must have been going through some difficult times. My mom just lost her husband. I'm like, how does that affect someone emotionally? And so my mom was grieving. My mom was probably in depression. My mom was probably in anxiety because she had to work to sustain us and work all these hours, and she must have been so tired. And then she comes home to a bunch of knuckleheads, you know, who don't clean and who don't listen to her. And so because of that, I understand where my mom was coming from. And so I don't judge my mom whatsoever, because I have 4 kids now. And I don't know how I would do it by myself. I would go crazy. Although my kids are great. My kids are great, but man, I don't know how I would do it. So as children, no matter what happens to us or what our moms are, we honor them as unto the Lord. And we respect them as unto the Lord. Here's another passage in Leviticus chapter 19, verse 3. "To all children, every one of you shall revere his mother and his father. You shall keep my Sabbaths. I am the Lord your God." So here is just a message for all the children: to honor your father and your mother. Give them high value in your heart. Give them a lot of weight in your heart as unto the Lord. But for the younger children, you are a child kind of like throughout your life. Very stages in your life. For the younger children, this is your role. For any younger children here, your job is to honor and obey. "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and your mother. This is the first commandment with a promise, that it may go well with you and that you may live long in the land. So for the younger children, your job is to honor and obey, because God has put your mother over you to guide and protect you and to teach you the way you should go. And it says here, if you do that, this is the only commandment with a promise. You got to pay attention to that. It's the only commandment with a promise. And the promise is that it will go well with you. Think about that. God says, if you honor your father and your mother and you obey them, it will go well with you. If I just listened to my mom, my life would go well when I was a kid. If I just listened to her, it would have gone well. When I was a kid, hey, brush your teeth. If I didn't listen to my mom, what happens? Cavities. Hey, go study. Go work. Go do this. Go do that. Just listen to, don't hang out with that group of guys. Don't stay out too late. Be careful. All these things. If I had just listened to my mom when I was younger, man, my life would have gone well. And that is God's promise for you. Because most mothers are good mothers and wanting to guide you and direct you and protect you and keep you safe. And so as a young child, your job is to honor and obey. And here's the thing. I work in a school. I work at a Christian school. And I'm telling you right now, this thing is not being followed. The disrespect that I see in young kids to the teachers, man, it starts in the home, right? And I could already foresee that this kid is going to have a hard life. It's not going to go well for this kid because he doesn't know how to show honor to first their mother and their father, and then the teachers. Man, this kid is not gonna, his life is not gonna go well. So that's a promise for younger children, is to honor and obey. For young adults, like if you're 20, 30 years old, 40 years old, and your mother and father are still alive, this is instruction for you. It is to honor and accept instruction. You are no longer obeying what your mother and father says. Now you're just accepting their instruction. And they're going to give you instruction, and now it's your responsibility to take it and decide for yourself if this is what you should do. Proverbs 1, 8 and verse 9 says, "Hear, my son, your father's instruction, and forsake not your mother's teaching, for they are a graceful garland for your head and pendants for your neck." So as adults now, you have your own mind now, and your obedience, if you're a believer, transfers over to God. And now your obedience is to God now. But your mother and father are still there to give you some instruction and some wise counsel. But the Bible says when there are a multiple of counselors, there's success. And so listening and just accepting some instruction and deciding for yourself what is good for you. But most mothers give really great advice. Now, if you are an older child, if you are like in your 50s and 60s and even 70s, and your mother is still alive, this is your role. It's to honor and care and take care of them. 1 Timothy 5:4 is talking about widows. And back in those days, widows didn't have anything. If you were a widow, you were the lowest. And so there was no one there to take care of you if your husband dies. And so it says, if a widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show godliness to their own household and to make some return to their parents, for this is pleasing in the sight of God. If you are an older child, as the older you get, your responsibility changes. From honor and to care and to be concerned about them. As a child, your parents sacrifice for you as a young child. Sacrifice, sacrifice, sacrifice. And I know my kids, they know that we sacrifice for them, but they don't know the details of how much we sacrifice for them. They don't understand the depthness of how much we sacrifice for them and how much we give of ourselves. And we sacrifice our own needs for them and to make sure that they go to a good school, they have a house, they have food, they have clothing, they have social life, they have all these things. My youngest son is 15 now. He's about to have a car or drive, and so I'm trying to give him a car, and I'm trying to convince him to take my used Element, Honda Element, 2003, but he doesn't want it. So, you do your best to provide for your kids, and you sacrifice for them, right? And then as you get older, though, it kind of switches. Now we as older parents, our back hurts, our health is going down, we don't have a job, we're based on retirement, all these things, and so now the role of the child, an older child now, is there to care and take care of the parent, of the mother. So that is a very amazing thing to honor and care. And here's the last thing for children. Be gracious to your mother. Be gracious to her and forgive her. Remember, mothers are not perfect. And so they make mistakes. Some of them, I know one youth that I had a long time ago, her mother was into addiction, which forced her to go into foster care. And she lived with foster care all her childhood, and she was so bitter, and she was so angry. But we worked with her to forgive her mother, because it's not perfect. You know that you need, you have to take a test for a driver's license, you have to do a written test, behind the wheel test. You have to go through a lot to be able to be a driver, to be a doctor. You got to go through 8 years of school and internship and all these things and tests and, to be a doctor. To be a lawyer, you got to go through all this school and then to take the bar exam. And you got to go through a lot to become these things. But it doesn't take much to be a parent. It just takes having a child. And many of us are not ready. We don't know how to handle a child. So a lot of times, mothers and fathers are learning all along the way. And as they're learning along the way, they make mistakes. And so as a child, learn to forgive as God has forgiven you. All right. So now word to the mothers, and I will close with this really fast. Here are some things that I have learned that are great qualities in a mother. Here are some first things. And we read the first one, word of truth to the mothers, fear God above all else. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain, but a woman who fears the Lord shall be praised. Give her the product of her hands and let her works praise her at the gates. This is what I've found, that a quality of a woman that gives strength, and that is that she fears the Lord. Because when she fears the Lord, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter 1, verse 7, when you fear the Lord, it's the beginning of wisdom. One of the key gifts that God gives to a mother who fears the Lord is wisdom. And wisdom is not knowledge. Wisdom is not intelligence. They're all part of it. But wisdom is knowing what God wants and doing what God wants. I've seen a lot of intelligent people do some stupid things. You have people in prison who are very intelligent, but they do stupid things. Wisdom is knowing what is right and doing it. And this quality in a mother, when she fears the Lord, God just gives her this amazing amount of wisdom on how to handle things and how to handle life. And she's not looking out for herself. Her main goal is, okay, how can I please the Lord in this motherhood? A woman who fears the Lord shall be praised. So as a mother, we need to desire wisdom, constantly pray for wisdom, and constantly live out wisdom in your life as God gives you wisdom. Because wisdom is the key. For me, as a counselor, as I talk to a lot of people, one thing I've learned is that what the keys to a good life is not money, it's not education, it's not intelligence, it's wisdom. And how to do things the right way and how God desires it is wisdom. And so a woman who fears the Lord, God gives wisdom. And wisdom, it says, is more precious than gold, more precious than silver. Charm is deceitful and beauty is vain. And this is a problem. In our world today, they glorify and they praise women who are charming and beautiful. Right? Online? They have filters now that makes women more beautiful. I'm like, one time there was this filter and this woman was so beautiful and then she took off the filter and I'm like, ooh. It's different. Don't be fooled by beauty. This passage is a king's mother, Lemuel's mother, telling this king, this is what you should look for. This quality you should look for. Don't be deceived by charm. Don't be deceived by beauty, because beauty fades and charm deceives. Don't look for that. You look for a woman with wisdom, the one who fears the Lord. And if you are a husband that has a wife that's full of wisdom, man, you are blessed. The Bible says those are hard to find. Hard to find. And so as a wife or as a mother, here's one of the truths that I want to share. Fear God above all else, because then wisdom comes. The next thing that I've seen in mothers who are successful and serving and steadfast is a mother who serves as unto the Lord. Colossians 3, 20 through 24, and whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for people-pleasing, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. A lot of times I've talked to mothers, and they've done all these things for their children. They do these things for people, for the approval of people. And then one day they're like saying, I've been doing all this for people. I've lost who I am. If you are, as a mother, if you are doing and serving your husband because of your husband, he's going to disappoint you. If you are serving your children because of your children, they're going to disappoint you. But if you serve the Lord, if you're doing these things as you're serving the Lord, then when your husband disappoints you, your children disappoint you, you're still there. You're still steadfast because what you're doing is as unto the Lord. As unto the Lord. And this is the one thing I've learned, that a lot of women are still learning. A lot of mothers are still learning. That serve as unto the Lord. And the last thing that I've seen, a good quality in mothers, is that they are thankful. The mothers who are thankful and have a heart of thankfulness, man, they endure. They endure. Because life is disappointing. Expectations sometimes aren't met. And if you live based on your expectations, man, you're going to be disappointed a lot in life. You're going to be unhappy in life. But the mothers that I've seen that are thankful to God for the little things, man, they have this special heart. Colossians 3:15, it says, let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, for this you were called as members of one body, and be thankful. 1 Thessalonians 5:18, it says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Man, if you have these three qualities as a mother, you fear the Lord above all else, and the reason why you're doing things is to glorify God and glorify Christ and to serve Christ, and then be having a thankful heart for all the little things, man, you're an amazing mother, and you'll be steadfast and immovable. The thankfulness, and I tell this to many people, thankfulness, and I told you guys as well, thankfulness is a weapon. Let me say that again. Thankfulness is a weapon. It's a weapon against depression. It's a weapon against despair. It's a weapon against a critical heart. It's a weapon against dissatisfaction. It's a weapon just not being satisfied with life. When you are thankful, it is a weapon. And that's why the Bible says here, give thanks in all circumstances, because they know, the Bible knows that giving thanks is a weapon against all circumstances. If you could find being thankful in every single circumstance, you have joy and you have happiness. And I always share this story, and I'll close with this story about a mother who gave thanks in all circumstances, and a father, and it gave. There's someone in our church who was having their first set of children, and I shared this with you before, but for those of you who haven't heard, their first children were triplets. Triplets. And we were so happy for them, and they were so excited. I don't know what I would do with triplets. I think we have a couple in our church that has twins, and man, I would not want their life. But with triplets, man, oof. But they were so happy with these triplets. But around the eighth month, the doctors came to them after a test and said, the lungs of your children aren't developing, and there's nothing that we could do about it. And so what's the prognosis then? Well, the doctor said, your children will be born regularly, but you'll only have 10 minutes with them because their lungs can't survive. And so you'll only have 10 minutes with them. And so they prepared for the delivery, and they prepared this organization called Angel's Wings, where they come in to take pictures of the baby, handprints, the feet prints, and all that stuff to make a memory of them. And so the babies were born, and they only had 10 minutes. Only had 10 minutes. And they all passed away. And and I had to be the one to do the funeral. And I was like, what in the world? How can I encourage these people? What can I say to comfort them? It's like, I mean, I would do the basic things, like share the gospel, share the love of God, but like as a pastor, like, how can I, what can I say to comfort these people? And I was praying, because I didn't know what to say, honestly. I was praying while I was sitting there before I go up. I said, God, Father, I don't know what to say. And then they sang a song, and then it was my turn to go up. And then God answered my prayer, because I didn't know what to say, but the Father knew what to say. And so, without me telling me, the Father went up to the pulpit. And, you know, I was like, okay, what is this guy going to say? And so I looked down, and this guy goes to the pulpit, and the first thing he says out of his mouth says, I thank God. The first thing that comes out of his mouth, I thank God. And I was like, what did he just say? Out of all this, he could still thank God, give thanks in all circumstances. And then he says, I thank God that I know what it means to be a father. Even if it was for 10 minutes, I know the heart of a father. He found that silver lining of thankfulness that changed his heart and changed his mind on how he views things. Then he says, I also thank God because I know of my faith in Christ Jesus, that there is a heaven, and I know that my little angels are in heaven, and I'll see them again, and I thank God for that. And that dad gave the message for me. And when I went up, I just followed what the dad said. And that mother and father, and the mother came up too as well, but that mother and father made this passage real to me, that to give thanks in all circumstances. Because of that, I know that this is possible. This is not just some verse. This is possible, that we can give thanks in all circumstances. So as a mother, I know you have gone through some hard things, some grief, some sorrow, some sadness. You might be going through some things right now. But here's the weapon. Be thankful. Find that thankfulness in all circumstances. And it is a power and it is a weapon that God has given all of us, but has especially given to you. Fear God, do things for the glory of God, and then be thankful for what Christ has done. And that is the heart of a mother who is worthy of praise. Let's pray. Dear Father God, thank you, Lord, for this day. And once again, Father, we just thank you, Lord, for this amazing role of motherhood. Help us, Father, as children, to honor our mothers, to obey them as young kids, to listen to their advice as young adults, and to care for them as older children, and to honor them and care for them. And Father, I pray for the mothers, Lord. Only you know what's going on in their hearts and their struggles and the things that they've gone through, the things that they're keeping in their heart, and the things, Father, they're going through even now. That, Father, help them, Lord, to know that fearing you above all else is a blessing, because wisdom will come. Help them, Father, to serve you and to glorify you in all that they do, and that you are the reason why, Father, that they are doing everything. And Father, help them, Lord, to give thanks in all circumstances, and it is the strength that will help them to endure. Thank you, Father, for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Why don't we all rise and we'll sing a closing song by Greg. And mothers, have a happy Mother's Day. A quick announcement. You see the decorations behind me. It is for an event called Kids Alive here in our church, where these kids do a play. And we're going to have a play on Saturday at 6 o'clock here, but also on Sunday at 10:45 if you want to come in and see some kids perform. It's all here, and I hope to invite you. Okay? Have a good day. Mother's Day. What is that? Oh, there's pictures in Facebook on our website or our Facebook page about the mothers here. All right, have a good day, everyone. Stand.